If you have your Bibles, I want you to look with me in Jonah, the third chapter this morning. While you're turning there, I want to test a little bit your knowledge of some country music. Any of you ever heard that song about what you get when you play a country music song backwards? I feel like I'm living that one out. What it comes down to is that the song says when you play a country music song backwards, you get your dog back, your truck back, your house back, and your wife back. Okay. Well, on Monday, I got my truck back out of the shop, praise God. And on Saturday, I got my wife back from a trip. So I feel like I'm living that song out. Welcome back, baby. It's good to have you home. Good to have you home. Now, don't Google that song while I'm preaching, but after church, you need to go listen to that, okay? Have you ever noticed how things change so quickly? Things can happen, can be popular one moment, and the next thing you know it, something else has taken over. Any of you got any Beanie Babies that you invested a lot of money in? Yeah, that changed just a little bit, didn't it? You got your bell-bottom jeans? Oh, hold on to them. They're kind of, I know it, sis. I hear that. I see that finger over there. They're coming back. Okay, hold on to it. I got you. Trends, fashions, toys, things can come and go. But it's helpful when there's so much change going on. It is helpful that there's a constant, several constants really, but the main constant through it all is God and His unchanging Word. Amen? The Lord said of Himself in the Old Testament book of Malachi 3, verse 6, the first part. He said, "For I am the Lord, I do not change." Hallelujah. God is without beginning and without end. He is a constant. And when it comes to His attributes and His character and His purpose for mankind, it is consistently the same. Throughout all the changes in history and all those that will happen in the future, God is the constant. Praise the Lord. But when we consider this unchanging God, one of the things that intrigues me about Him is that we read in the Scripture that there were times when God changed His mind. Well, how can an unchanging God change His mind about something? I'm glad you asked that question. We're going to see an example of that from the story of Jonah. I don't know if you know about this, but there's this story in the book, in the Bible, about this guy who was named Jonah, who had a relationship with God, and God wanted him to go do something at a particular area, and Jonah decided he wasn't going to do it. He wanted him to go to Nineveh and preach to them, and instead he decided to get on a ship and go to Tarshish. You guys didn't have a port of call in Tarshish, I hope. Okay, just checking. That's the equivalent of God telling us, somebody here today, you need to go to Beckley and do something, and you say okay, and you get out on the turnpike and you head to Withful, okay? He went the opposite direction. But God relentlessly showed up and got Jonah's attention, sent this great big storm, and they ended up tossing him off of that ship. None of that happened either, right? Okay, good. And God sent this great fish to swallow Jonah up whole and bring him to Nineveh, and that great fish got some cosmic indigestion and spit him out on the shore. Yeah, that's a good thought to think about, isn't it? Jonah had heard the word of the Lord in the belly of that great fish, and he decided, you know what, I think God's way is better. I think I'll do what God has for me to do now. And last week we saw some of the greatest words in the Scripture, in my humble yet accurate opinion. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Jonah had a chance. A second chance to go and do what God had for him to do. And now as we pick his story up, he is going into this great city of Nineveh that it's going to take him 3 days to walk through. And let's see what happens. Look with me in your Bible in Jonah 3. We're going to actually begin at verse 4 and go through verse 10. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. And he cried out and he said, "Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown." So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. Then the word came to the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne and laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, "Let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil way, from the violence that's in his hands. Who can tell if God will turn and relent?" Note that word. "And turn away from his fierce anger so that we may not perish." In verse 10, perhaps one of the greatest verses in Scripture. "Then God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it." Do you see what's happening in the Scripture here? Jonah finally gets to Nineveh. He finally, after repenting himself before the Lord, says, "All right, I'm going to do what God's called me to do." And he gets up to the city gates. He's got to walk 3 days' journey to get through the entire place. He's on day one of the journey. And theologians have studied this, and they believe that after this guy has been in the belly of a great fish for 3 days, when that thing spit him out on dry ground, he came out of the belly of that great fish with not a hair on his head because of the juices and the digestive chemicals in the whale's body, or the great fish's body. He didn't have any hair on him. It had bleached him ghostly white. And he's walking through the city giving the message to the people, "Repent! The Lord's going to destroy this place in 40 days. It's going to be overtaken in 40 days. My, what a sight that would have been." Now, I've done a few things in preaching to try to get people's attention, but I don't want to be bleached white and bald. But here is this fella nonetheless, proclaiming the word that God has placed on his heart. And he's telling the truth. Remember, Nineveh was an evil culture. It was an evil people. They overtook other people with no thought about what was going on. They killed people. They raped, pillaged, and plundered just to get more. They were evil incarnate. And God was giving them mercy in the form of Jonah, saying, "You need to change your ways." God was dead set on destroying and overtaking that land, not because God was mad or because God is evil, but because sin gets judged. Make no mistake about that. God doesn't hate anybody, but he hates sin. And sin brings judgment. And the Ninevites were in danger of that judgment coming. God was sending that judgment, but he gave them a chance to avert that. And as they heard the word of the Lord, they did what every preacher hopes on any given Sunday morning. They not only heard it, but they took heed to it. According to the Scripture, they said, "Oh my goodness, we better get right with God." They repented. All the people started hearing, and God just showed up in a special way that day. And they came under conviction, and they were like, "You know what? We got to change our ways." They, from the top citizen, from the top officials, all the way down to any citizen in the land, heard what God was saying, And they had a change of heart and mind. They repented of their sins. Did you catch in there that the king even repented? All that God would give us leaders in this land who truly do what He wants done. May anyone who might be, and I'm not calling any of them out by name, but any of them who aren't doing what God wants them to do, hear the gospel and repent. And any of them who are about to get into office that need to step up and live right, may they get right and repent. May God raise up godly leaders in this land. But not just at the White House, but in your house and mine. Amen? The king of Nineveh heard the word. He came under conviction. He said, you know what? There's somebody greater than us. And though I'm king of Nineveh, I submit to him. And he gave evidence of that. He put on sackcloth. He sat in ashes. He made a decree to the entire land. Don't let man nor beast eat or drink anything. We're going to prove there's a change of heart here. We can't earn the destruction to go away, but we can repent and show there's a change in us. But wait a minute, there's a problem. God's already said 40 days, in less than 40 days, this place is going to be ashes. It's going to be overtaken. And God doesn't change, right? Well, God changed His mind in this case. Because when God saw, according to the Scripture, that the people had repented, He relented and did not send destruction. God changed His mind. But here's what you need to understand and what I need to understand. God relented because Nineveh repented. You catch that? It's not so much necessarily that God had changed His mind, but they changed theirs. And when we repent, that changes the whole story for us. God relented because the people repented. And today I want you to understand, if you're on a path that goes against what God wants you to do, you are in danger of personal destruction. You're in danger eternally of hellfire if you die that way. And you are in danger of bringing other things on your life while you're still alive because you're not living in accordance to God's word. And God calls you and me to repent and live as He would have for us to live. When we repent, God relents. When we repent, God changes His mind. But today, as we hear this message, and remember, Nineveh wasn't living the way God wanted them to live. And they had to make a true change in order for God to change what was about to happen. Today, I want you to know beyond the shadow of any doubt a few things. One, God's not mad at you. Nor does He hate you. There are a lot of people in this nation right now that are concerned. They think some people might think God hates them, but a lot of people think this new administration is going to hate them and do horrible things to them. I don't know what's going to happen all down through there, but I will tell you this. The God in heaven that I serve, He doesn't hate anybody. And He's not mad at individuals. What God hates is sin. And again, He's going to bring judgment on sin because sin is everything that God is not. But God doesn't hate anybody. And He's not mad at anybody. Matter of fact, God is love. God loved this world so much that He gave His only begotten Son that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. God does not want to see anybody destroyed. He's the one that put on flesh and dwelt among us and got nailed to a cross so that none of us would ever have to perish. God's not mad at you and He doesn't hate you. And He's not desirous that you go into destruction. 2 Peter 3:9 tells us that God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He's patient towards us. and desperately wants us to be living the life that He has for us. He wants us to repent. Now listen to me. None of us, no human beings ever going to be able to stand before God Almighty and say we didn't have the proper chance to come to repentance. You're hearing it today because I'm preaching it to you. And most of you have been here before and you've heard me preach this before. And once you have knowledge of something, you're accountable for it. Amen? And if you ever get to thinking about all the people out there who might not have a chance to hear somebody preach or teach like I'm doing for you today, just understand God's got that covered as well. In Romans, the first chapter, the second chapter, verses 1 through 4, we find these words. Therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge. For in whatever you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you who judge and practice the same things, but know that the judgment of God is coming according to the truth against those who practice such things. And do you think that, oh man, that you who judge and practicing such things and are doing the same, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you despise the riches of His goodness, forbearance, and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads to repentance? You see, God in His goodness has various ways of revealing Himself to people all around this world, and we all will be without excuse when we stand before Him. What God is calling us to do is to repent of sin and live the way that He wants us to live. That's what Nineveh did. God changed his mind or relented because Nineveh repented. Jesus' message in the gospel included repentance. In Mark chapter 1, beginning at verse 14, we find these words. And after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel." This thing called repentance is a big deal, amen? And I'm afraid we've forgotten about it in modern times. God's not mad at you, nor does He hate you. He loves you so much, He gave His only Son to die for you. Those who believe on Him will not perish. But we've got to understand, in order to accurately and truly believe, it includes repenting. It includes changing our ways. So I'm going to give you very quickly today the ABCs of repentance. And remember, you can't get right with God without repenting. Had Nineveh not repented, God would not have relented. You got that? Good. I'm going to say it about 30 more times before we leave. So what's it mean to repent? Well, the first thing you got to do is you got to admit you were wrong. You got that? You got to be willing to say, you know what? I'm wrong. David in Psalm 51:3 says, "For I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is always before me." If you won't admit you're wrong, you can't repent. How can you get right about something if you don't think you're wrong about it? Now, I don't know how it is for you and my brothers today. Let me speak to us for a moment. But guys sometimes have a problem with this, or maybe I'm the guy that has a problem with this. I don't know. I can admit I'm wrong, and trust me, I'm on a journey to develop in that and have been for quite some time. I can admit I'm wrong when I'm wrong, but you better be ready to prove I'm wrong. You know what I mean? I'm that guy that keeps a tape measure handy. If you say it's 8 feet long and I think it's 7, we're going to go measure it. Absolutely, buddy, absolutely. But maybe guys or gals, you share this problem with me. I'm not the only guy who has struggled with this. Look at this little clip from several decades ago now.
Don't forget that Fonz real. I mean, it's not important.
It's
figured I'd hang at the barracks and cheer up the guys.
Mal, you're not going to hang these up at any barracks because you're not going to join the Marines. Just take all this stuff home, okay?
But Fonzie, not join? I'm all packed. You told me it was the right thing to do.
Look, I know what I told you to do, but when I told you to do that, I was... Ralph, I was... I was not exactly right.
What do you mean, not right?
I mean, not right.
I don't get you. You mean you were wrong?
Yeah, that's right, Malfa. I was what you just said I was just then, yeah.
Wrong? The Fonz wrong?
Malf, look. There is a first time for everything, huh?
I don't understand Fonz.
Can anybody other than me identify with the Fonz in that? Sometimes it's hard for us to admit we're wrong. But listen to me clearly. You cannot repent. You cannot get right with God until you first clearly realize and are willing to admit you're wrong. We figured this out throughout human history. You ask anybody who's a part of a 12-step program, the first thing they've got to do to get help is they got to admit they have a problem. And you cannot, you will not get the help you need until you admit there's a problem, until you admit you are wrong. But it's more than just admitting you're wrong. You've got to have a genuine sorrow. You've got to be genuinely sorry for your wrong. 2 Corinthians 7, verses 9 and 10 says, "Now I rejoice not that you were made sorry, but that your sorrow led to repentance. For you were made sorry in a godly manner, that you might suffer loss from us in nothing. For godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted, but the sorrow of this world produces death." You see, if we're going to truly repent, we have to admit we were wrong, and then we've got to be genuinely sorry for that wrong and the harm that it's caused us and or others. We have to have a sorrow for sin. Now listen to me. I've spent some time doing prison ministry, and I found out very quickly, early on in going into a prison setting, they found out you're a preacher and you get to talking to them. Everybody in there is sorry. Everybody in prison is sorry. They stand before the judge, they're sorry. And yet, the overwhelming majority, unfortunately, of those who go into prison, many of them will say, to be kind, many of them, as soon as they say they're sorry and get out, guess what happens? They go right back to doing what they are doing. And they end up back in prison. That's called recidivism, okay? And hear me today. Those people, in most cases, aren't sorry for what they did. They were sorry they got caught. Now, I dare say every one of us in the room at some point have been sorry we got caught. Oh, come on, don't you look at me like that. Them blue lights flash in your rearview mirror. First thing, oh, you're sorry you were speeding. I'm sorry I was speeding, officer. I was in a hurry, da-da-da-da-da. And half of us are going to just go right on our merry way if we get talked out of that ticket. We're at least going to drive the speed limit until we get on down the road, right? Yeah, don't you lie to me. There's an altar call coming. To get right with God, you got to do more than just be sorry you got caught. You got to be sorry for sin itself and for what it's done to you and to others, and most importantly, to the heart of God. You got to admit you're wrong. You got to be genuinely sorry for your sin. The letter C in this ABCs is this: you got to confess your wrong to God and sometimes others. 1 John 1 and 9 says this: if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Praise God. When we admit we're wrong, when we're truly sorry that we're wrong, and we confess that to God, we get to that point of, Lord, I have sinned and I'm truly sorry. I confess this to you. He promises me in his word, he will cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Praise the Lord. That's repentance. That's confessing to the Lord. That's receiving, opening up the forgiveness that comes only through Christ's name. That changes our eternal destiny. That changes our lives in the here and now. And it does not come until we admit we have genuine sorrow and we confess. And sometimes this confession needs to go to somebody other than just God. James 5:16 says this, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now hear me today, the first person you've got to confess to get right with God is God. But sometimes what you're wrestling with, you need a brother or a sister. You need the right person to go to that you can trust. And you've got to look at them and you've got to say, you know what? I've done this, or I'm struggling with this, and I need you to pray for me so that I can be healed from this. No, we don't have to go to a priest. No, we don't have to go through this person or that person for salvation. But sometimes to get some sin dealt with, it includes looking somebody in the eye and saying, pray for me, my brother. Pray for me, my sister. Here's what's going on, and I want your help. True repentance brings about confession. Sometimes that confession shows up in the form of you got to go to a brother or sister that you've wronged, and you got to try to make it right. Now, you're not responsible for what they're going to do in their response to it, but you are responsible for your end in this. Well, that's interesting, Ray, but is it in the Bible? Oh, thank you for asking. Thank you for asking that. Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse 23. Look at what Jesus says. Matthew 5, verses 23 and 24. Jesus said, therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come offer your gift. Look at what Jesus himself said to his people that day in that congregation. He says it to us today. Hey, if you show up at church and you're about to worship me and you remember, you know what, there's aught between me and this person. You know what? Leave the church service and go hunt them down. Before you can properly worship the Lord, you got to do what you can to try to make it right with that person. Now understand, there's only so much you can do. I get that. But you got to be clean before God that you've done your part with that. And sometimes that means going and confessing to somebody that you've wronged. Oh, listen to me today. Nineveh was about to be demolished and overtaken. They heard the word of God, and they didn't just believe it. They repented. They changed their ways. They admitted they were wrong. They were genuinely sorry for their wrong. They confessed their wrong. And the proof of their repentance showed up in how they lived. They put on sackcloth and sat in ashes. They quit running around killing everybody needlessly. They brought forth fruit of repentance. Does that make any sense? Do you realize today that in order to truly repent, there's got to be a change? It might be a change of attitude. It might be a change of action. It might be a change of heart. It might be all three of those things and a whole lot more, but there's got to be a change. If this behavior and this thought pattern is driving this behavior that is against what God wants us to do, we've got to not only believe in our hearts, but we've got to repent, and then we've got to act differently. Well, okay, Ray, that sounds a little strong to me. Is that in the Bible? Thank you for asking that one too. Oh, look in the Scripture. Isaiah, the 55th chapter, The seventh verse says, let the wicked continue in his way. Right? I got that wrong. No, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Keep that verse up there for a moment. Look at what God's saying here. If we want to have the abundant pardon, and if we want to have the mercy of God, part of that includes our part in this, where we have to forsake, where we have to change our thinking by the power and the grace of God. This thing of getting right with God includes believing, but it also includes repenting. It was the repentance of Nineveh that caused God to relent of his thoughts towards them. Are you catching this? Look at what the scripture says in Proverbs 28:13. He who covers his sins will get by with it. No! He who covers his sins will not prosper. But whoever confesses, if I just confess, let's block that other part out. Write out those two other words, okay? Just take those out of your mind. All I got to do is confess. Lord, I believe on you. I love you, Jesus. Thank you for loving me. I'm just going to confess, but I'm not going to change. Oh, hear me, my friend. That's not the Bible, and that's not repentance. And that is not going to cause God to relent like Nineveh did. According to the scripture, he who covers his sin will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. Listen to me. If we're going to live in the grace and the mercy of God that he wants to so wonderfully give each and every one of us, we've got to be willing to not only believe it, but we've got to repent, and that includes changing our ways. That means if you're hating somebody, you got to do the hard work and quit hating. That means if you're lusting and you're giving yourself over to pornography, you've got to repent of that and change your ways. You catching me? You can't just, I believe, and keep living the way you've been living. That means you can't be fooling around with somebody you're not married to. I believe. Wait a minute. The Word says this. But I believe. Well, you better change your ways. That means you got to get off some of those drugs you're using. You got to quit getting drunk, because the Word says that's not what we're supposed to be doing. Now listen to me. It might mean you got to change some of your language. It might mean you got to quit talking about all those other people because you're not doing X, Y, or Z, but you know some people who are, and you're telling everybody about it. You see, repentance calls for a change. And I'm here to tell you today, my friends, until you are willing to admit you're wrong and you're to be genuinely sorry for that wrong and to confess it and forsake it, you've not truly stepped into the repentance that God wants you to have. Now listen to me. I get that it doesn't always happen at once. It didn't happen for me at once. I confessed and believed on the Lord Jesus Christ when I was 16 years of age, and I got up from that altar of prayer and I knew beyond the shadow of a doubt my sins had been forgiven. But I also found out as I walked on this journey that, one, I didn't know everything that I was going to have to change that second. But the things that I knew, I was then accountable and responsible for. And by the grace of God, I had to start changing some of those things. There's some things you might be doing today that you've known for a long time you shouldn't be doing. You need to quit. And quitting and changing your behavior might mean you got to do more than kneel at an altar of prayer and pray, although that's a great start. Changing your way can include getting some professional help to find out why you keep going back to that pattern of behavior to begin with. And yes, God is gracious. I know He's been gracious for me. But I also know this. I don't ever want to frustrate the grace of God. Anything that I know to be wrong, and I admit it, and I'm sorry that I'm caught up in that, and I've got that genuine sorrow, and I'm confessing it to Him, then with His help, I've got to change my ways. And hear me today. If you want to believe some simple idea that all I have to do is believe, and I don't care what the Word says, and I don't care what God wants, I've believed, I've been dunked, I'm okay, I'm telling you, you're in trouble. You're in grave trouble because it's not what the Word says. I am so glad today that God changed His mind about Nineveh. I'm glad He relented, but He didn't do it until they repented. And that repentance means that you change your thinking, change in behavior, change of heart, a change of whatever is against what God wants done. Oh, let me remind us, God isn't mad at you. God does not want to destroy you. God loves you and He's got a better plan for your life. But in order to get in on that plan, you got to do more than just say, well, I believe in Jesus. You got to believe in Him. You got to admit your sin. You got to be sorry for that sin. And then you've got to confess and walk a different way. The grace of God will help you change. But you got to be on that journey to change. Now, what about you today? You believed, praise the Lord. You've confessed, hallelujah. I know it's not easy to admit you're wrong. You've got this genuine sorrow. You want to have a change in your life. You are the prime candidate for God to do a miracle. It may be instantaneous or it may take some time, but I'm here to tell you today, you let God do it. You walk in obedience to what He wants you to do. Oh, He is merciful. Oh, He is gracious. He's the only one that can bring about this change. And taking the steps to let Him change you is the best decision you will ever make. As our song leaders come forward and lead us in this closing song, I want to know, is there something you need to genuinely repent of? Is there something that you've been struggling with that needs to change? Would you like to come to this altar and say, you know what, God, I know You love me, and I know Your plan's better, and I want in on Your way. All the destruction that was coming to Nineveh didn't come. God relented because they genuinely repented. Is there anything you need to repent of today? Come on, while we have this time together. These altars are open.